So we shall start, sir.
Yes,
So very good afternoon to one and all present. Hope everyone is safe and at home. So I thank Mr. G. Sivaram Reddy, the director of LSB Temerity Infra Private Limited, Hyderabad, for accepting to deliver this lecture on analysis and design of steel pre-engineered buildings. I welcome respected HOD faculty members and all the students for this program. Since we have this topic on pre-engineered buildings and analysis using software in the latest syllabus also, Regulation 18, so I think it will be very useful for the students. And otherwise also, it is a very fast-growing industry where everybody requires to know this. Now I request Ms. Nancy of third year to introduce the speaker to the participants.
Thank you, ma'am. We all welcome you, sir. Mr. Sivaram Reddy has completed his BTech in civil engineering in 2006 from Vienna Vijnana Jyothi Institute of Engineering and Technology, Bachubali, Hyderabad. After a few years of experience in civil industry, he has joined the master program in Mosnania University, Hyderabad, and completed his post-graduation in structural engineering. Sivaram Reddy, sir, has worked in various well-established companies nationally and internationally. He has 14 plus years of rich engineering expertise in detailed design and review engineering of infra projects for railway and highway projects, high-rise and commercial buildings, multimodal logistic hub, PEB warehouses, marine structures, oil and gas, thermal power plants and cement plants for both green and brown fields. Besides the above experience, he has also a significant exposure on construction and project management services. He has 4 years of international experience in Oman, Indonesia, Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Singapore. He is entitled as a chartered engineer and a member of Institution of Engineers. He has also delivered various case lectures and conducted workshops on civil software to the civil engineering aspirants at many reputed colleges, which motivated the students to understand the real skills to be developed in oneself to be hired in the industry. His strength in civil engineering soon propelled him to establish a corporate company separately named LSB Temerity Infra Private Limited, which was started purely for the purpose of providing the best technical services in the civil engineering industry. And he also wants to be an icon of the civil engineering aspirants by providing them the best corporate training in the structural design. We welcome, sir.
Thank you so much, Nancy, for introducing me to the participants. Thank you so much, Rogi Ma'am and HOD sir, also for giving me this opportunity to interact with you and to explain how this PEB, in the sense of pre-engineered buildings, are going to be designed. Now, in today's session, we are going to discuss about this overview of designing, analysis and design of these PEB structures. Yes, let us start our session. So for today's session is about design of PEB steel structures, and today is 29 May 2021. Myself is Shivaram Reddy, and we are from LSB Temerity Infra Private Limited. Before we are going to get into this session, a very brief about LSB Temerity, and we are having this kind of a services, consultancy services, PMC services, construction services, and of course, corporate training online and offline services also. So structural design consultancy services, in the sense we are having our core strength itself is structural design. So since I'm having almost more than 14 years of plus experience, we are completely into this structural design consultancy as our core strength. Myself here, Shivaram Reddy. This is my total experience. And I worked in buildings, bridges designs, oil and gas, thermal power plants, cement plants designs. I'm nearly having 5 years of international experience. I worked in Indonesia, Singapore, Oman, and Qatar. These are things we have done in the last 1 year. These are achievements. Now it's more than, we have done more than this. And these are all the interesting things that we have designed, like hospital buildings. So initially, we had around 27 columns located for the hospital building. We changed it to 18 columns only. So what I'm trying to tell you here is, we always make our structure more economical and of course more effective. In the space utilization. So first case in the hospital building, initially we were having 27 columns, and then we changed it to only 18 columns to utilize this space very effectively. That is the challenging factor that we experienced in it. And then we have designed long span buildings and then apartment buildings with the board cast piles. And then for function hall with a 60 feet long span. And then we designed one of the very small residential building. However, interesting thing here is, fifth point, interesting thing here is, we have designed underrimmed pile foundations to this residential building. And the sixth point, you can see this is a pre-engineering building. Of course, later on, we also have designed n number of pre-engineering buildings with more challenges. But here, the challenging thing here is, our uniqueness of this building is, we have designed this building considering this board cast pile foundations. And the seventh point, we have reviewed 30 floors buildings, 30 floors height building. And then remaining all other minor buildings, we have designed more than 10. And then corporate training, we have conducted this corporate training for more than 250 members who are done with this UG and then PG. And of course, we are also consulting. We are also people who are supporting this other small scale consultancies from our core structural engineering services. And we have conducted webinars more than 15 or 16. We mentioned like around 1 to 5. And last year, when this was lockdown, so we had conducted the training on 16 topics and we trained more than 2,000 members in hardly 4 months. Very recently, also again, we started our online training sessions through the webinars almost 1 month back. We are completely into this online services now. Yes, overview of pre-engineering building design. So what exactly is the pre-engineering building? What do you mean of analysis? What do you mean of design? Why should I need to design this structure? Where this structure would be? What is the advantage of the structures, right? We can just put n number of questions. We can just phrase n number of questions, and then we can understand how these kind of structures will be designed. First thing is, under this overview of pre-engineering building, first point is design flow chart of steel building. For any kind of a structure, I personally prefer to explain the things through the design flow chart. Because once you come to know the design procedure from scratch level to the submission of structural drawings, then you'll be understanding entire thing. I mean, this process first we'll discuss, and we'll start implementing the process by creating this architectural drawings or also called as general arrangement drawings. And then we will design this structure using STAD or ETAC software. And then we'll ensure that the structure is more safe, stable, and is having enough strength to resist the all kind of loads, which is depending on the structure where it is located. And of course, depending on the geometric shape and whether it is having any kind of a crane loads or it is not having any other, I mean, excluding this crane loads, right? And then once we can design it, next thing is we need to just present all the details, like structural details in the sense, footing, foundation details, pedestal details, column details, and then other components which are there in this structure. Such kind of details have to be presented in the form of structural details, which are going to be sent to the site for execution. So that is a full set that we can just discuss from this design flowchart. And then next is a PAB introduction, and then components of PAB building, code books to be referred. What are the code books that need to be referred? And then material specification, design assumptions, types of supports, loads and combinations, and other criteria. So these are the wonderful lines, concepts that we have to just understand it. So here we mentioned like introduction to the PEB. So what is this PEB and where we can use such kind of things we'll discuss from introduction to this PEB. And then components. Once we can understand, we will take only one building and we'll just see the components. First, we have to have idea on the components. What is this girt? What is this purlin, rafter, column, shaped columns, right? And then what is the type of sheet that we are going to use? What is the advantage of this structure? Where we can keep openings? If I keep openings more than 20%, what is really going to happen to this structure? Such kind of things will be discussed. Once we become familiar with this components of the PEB building, next thing is we have to have an idea on the code books which we are supposed to use to design this kind of a buildings. And then once we come to know the type of code books that we need to refer for designing it, next we have to focus on the material specification. Material specification in the sense, since we have different components in the PAB structure, in fact, PAB is a steel structure, unlike RCC. Unlike RCC means in the case of RCC building, hardly we use only one type of grade of concrete or or then we can go to this grid of state, like rebar state. It can be 415, 500, 550 or so on. So when it comes to this steel structure, especially the PV structure, it'll have a different kind of a material specification. So it is always advisable to gain knowledge on this material specification. Accordingly, we can just economize the structure when we are designing it. And then design assumptions. Whatever we are studying from this academics, first we have to know what we are studying it, and then what is the relation between this academics and then the realistic condition or real-time scenario to apply such kind of assumptions when we are analyzing and designing a structure. So there are some design assumptions. We have to just go through the design assumptions and make sure that the model that we are preparing it and the loads we are applying or we are considering it and the way we are designing it are in line with the assumptions that we have studied from our academics. There might be a gap between this academics and the real-time scenario, but still, it doesn't mean that it is completely changing to 180 degrees. It is not like this, but we have to thoroughly understand the assumptions, and wherever there are practical aspects or practical things that we need to consider, then we just change our assumptions and we finally ensure the structure is completely safe and stable. And then types of supports. We have studied many things like fixed support, pinned support, or we can say fixed beam, pinned beam, continuous beam, or we can say double overhang beam, propped cantilever beam. What kind of the situation we can use such kind of a concepts in practical scenario are very more important. And trust me, and the design of a steel structure is always complicated comparatively design of any other type of structures, especially concrete material. Concrete material, you hardly find one type of profiles. One type in the sense, most of the occasions you find only rectangular profiles or rectangular cross sections. Or hardly, sometimes it can be a circular section, circular columns. Such kind of a circular columns we can see maybe in our colleges, or maybe in the hotels, or maybe to the any monumental structures, right? So other than these rectangular or circular sections, you do not find any different kind of a profiles in the case of a RCC building. But when it comes to the steel building, trust me, there are n number of profiles. Like you can say I sections, channel sections, and then double angle sections, and then equal angle, unequal angle sections. You can select n number of profiles, and you can just join them. You can just join them as we wish it. So why I'm telling you is whatever the theory that we are studying, that would be very effectively that can be very effectively utilized when we are designing only steel buildings compared to RCC buildings. So you must be very perfect in this theoretical concepts, then you can apply them in this. I mean, you are going to apply all this theoretical concept at least 80% when you are designing your steel structures. That's why when you can just observe, you do not find many people are working on this steel structure designs because you must be applying or you must be in contact with this theoretical concepts often when you are designing the steel structures. In the case of RCC structure, only two profiles, either rectangular or circular. And moreover, all of them are rigidly connected. But when it comes to this steel structure, just compare these two. Everywhere there will be a very significant difference between these two. In the case of RCC, you just keep the reinforcement and then provide the secondary and the pour concrete. Done. But when it comes to the steel structure, every joint is important. And every practical material specification, material availability, and then thicknesses, more important. When it comes to this RCC structure, we will also use the standard column sizes, like 9 inches by 15 inches, 9 inches by 18 inches, or 9 inches by 9 inches by 2 feet or so on. But when it comes to this steel structure, we'll have different types of the profiles with the different thicknesses. So you have to have very enormous knowledge when you are ready to design this steel structures. Right, we'll study about these types of supports, and then once you can just understand that components and then code books to be referred, in a sense we are just collecting the data which is required for designing this structure, and we have to be very familiar with the material specification or type of materials, and we have to know all the design assumptions what we know from the theory, and if there is any deviation we have to ensure that is compatible with the theoretical lines. And then types of supports, the types of supports that we are studying would be effectively going to be used in the case of steel structure designs. I'm not saying whether it is a pre-engineered structure or rolled section structure. Whatever it is, if it is a steel structure, You have to be very careful, and then of course all the theoretical concepts have to be thoroughly applied in this stage structure design. And then once we are done with this types of supports and then applying this supports to this structure, then you have to add this loads and then the combinations, and then finally other criteria. Let us talk a very brief about design flowchart. Here, design flowchart nothing but what is a design? Design of a structure. What does this design of a structure means? When we see it is a design of a structure. Structure is a design, which means the design structure is satisfying all these three criteria. First criteria is stability, strength, and serviceability. Stability in the sense structure should be first stable, means structure should be there at the same position only. It doesn't mean that if I construct the structure at one particular location today, it should not move to the next place maybe tomorrow, right? So stability is nothing but structure should be satisfying this sliding criteria and then overturning criteria. Sliding criteria in the sense structure should not be sliding. Usually this is sliding criteria, or we can say stability criteria, is more important. This is in the case of the dams and retaining walls, where we have an impact of lateral force impact is very significant. And moreover, trust me, it is also very equally important in the case of the steel structures. Steel structure is not really going to be, entire structure is not really going to be slided or not going to be overturned. But components of this steel structures have to be verified for this criteria. So structure should not be slided and should not be overturned. So that is what the stability criteria is. We have to verify and ensure structure is more stable, which means it is satisfying sliding criteria and also overturning criteria. This is sliding criteria, I mean this stability criteria is more especially to the structures where those are meant only to resist the horizontal forces. Better examples are retaining walls and the dams. And the steel structures, yes, it is slightly important when we are verifying this individual components. And then strength criteria, in that means a entire structure and then structural components should be having enough strength to resist the moments and then forces. What are those moments? There will be two types of moments. One is bending moment, second one is twisting. Forces, one is shear force, axial force, that's it. So if you can just ensure that the structural component or structure is capable of resisting this bending moments and then twisting moments, shear force and the axial forces, then the structure is having enough strength to resist all this analytical resistance. And then serviceability. Serviceability in the sense, of course, the structure is completely stable. We have verified it. And structure and structural components also are having enough strength. Okay, it is done. And then serviceability criteria in the sense, it comes under maintenance requirement. Maintenance requirement in the sense, after we have constructed the building, maybe over a period of time, around 10 years or 15 years, structural components should not lose its strength, right? And structural components, especially vertical deflections and the lateral deflections, such kind of deflections should be under control. So that is what is a serviceability criteria is. Structure might have been passed under stability criteria, maybe every element is having enough strength. However, structural components and the structure also should be satisfied. Serviceability criteria, which means deflection criteria. Means structural component should not be yielding to significant amount of deflections. So once we are sure it is passing stability, strength and serviceability, so we are now done with this design. However, whatever we have done with this design, what are the profiles that we are getting, and however these structural components are getting connected, all those details have to be very thoroughly given in this form of structural drawings, and those structural drawings have to be released to the site. So based on those structural drawings only, site execution team or site execution people will execute or erect to this steel building. So out of all these things, and connections are more important in the case of a steel structure, because if you can forget, maybe the diameter of the bolt is same, number of bolts are also very same. When grade of bolts are changed, what do you do? Instead of using 8.8, but they would have used 4.6, which means almost 50% of strength is reduced. What do you do? Nothing, connections get failed. So that's why we have to thoroughly verify each and every corner when you're designing a steel structure. Such amount of knowledge, I mean, such amount of attention it might not be required to design other structures, but in the case of a steel structure, it's very important. Yes, now we just have seen this kind of a introduction. What exactly is a pre-engineered building? Why should I need to do this? So pre-engineered structure is nothing but, let me say I have a One second, please. Is there any control that I can draw something on this screen? Arubhi ma'am, are you there?
We are able to see the cursor.
Yeah, cursor is fine. I mean, is there any option that I can make a
At the bottom, there, sir, at the bottom left side.
Yeah, okay. Can I take
inside
any...
Inside your tool? PPT itself, sir. You can see
one
very
second.
Like the blue color triangle area, you can see now, sir, in your slide.
Yeah.
There itself, there'll be one pen.
Yeah, one second. I'll go to this. One second, ma'am. Can I take any tool here?
Okay, if you want to take that, then that whiteboard will be a complete whiteboard if you want to.
Okay. Then from there, I think I can use tools.
Otherwise, on the PPT itself, if you want to draw on below the.
Yeah, that is enough, ma'am. I want to draw something on the PPT itself.
Yes, sir. There, in that blue triangle area, you can see small
blue
little
triangle.
In your slide, sir, in your slide design itself, at the bottom is there, sir.
Yeah. One second, ma'am.
Just move your cursor down, sir, a little further down.
Yes, ma'am.
On left
yeah.
side.
Yeah, thank you so much. Sorry. Yeah, sorry. Thank you so much. Yeah. Yes. So here we have pre-engineering building, right? So pre-engineering building, and then pre-engineering in the sense, for example, I have a column like this and one more, this portal frame. We have a portal frame like this, right? So when I have a portal frame like this, you can just take this window and diagram. I'll have a window and diagram like this, right? So this way, and of course we'll have a window and diagram like this, right? So we'll have a window and diagram like this again. And again, we'll have a window and diagram like this. So what we are saying is the concept of the pre-engineering building comes into the picture when we are looking for economy, in the sense when we are having very, very large spans. Usually in the case of RCC building, the spans would be very lesser, like it would be only hard 6 meters or 8 meters, or sometimes it can be 12 meters hardly, which is even if we can just go beyond 12 meters in span, we have to go for post-tension concepts. But when it comes to the steel buildings, most of the occasions you would have noticed with this kind of things, like a truss concepts. We'll be using this kind of a truss concepts only. I'll have like this, and then like this again, and then you use these concepts, truss concepts, right? What happens is when we are having very huge span like this, now this may be around 20 meters or 30 meters only. If I wanted to make very huge span like 35 meters, 45 meters, 60 meters, sometimes we can even design this structure for 100 meters of span. 100 meters of span means without keeping any kind of intermediate column, we can just maintain 100 meters of span in the case of a steel structure, which is highly impossible for other cases. So that is where this kind of a pre-engineering building is playing a very extraordinary role. So pre-engineering in a sense, when I use this first concept, let me say it is a rolled concepts, rolled section concepts. In a sense, there are standard steel profiles that we usually very normally go through from our academics, like ISMB sections, angle sections, channel sections, tubular sections, and then square sections, rectangular sections. All those sections are standard sizes, which means ISMB 300, ISMB 400. So for ISMB 400, flange thickness, flange width, web depth, weather web thickness, these are very standard things. So what I'm saying is, for a conventional steel structure, they can straight away take this standard profiles which are available in the market, and then you can execute it. But the weight of those materials will be very huge, and moreover, we are not effectively utilizing the material in the case of the rolled sections. So what we do is, as per exact this bending moment requirement, let me say, one second please. I want to clear this.
Then we can screen like show or hiding command, that's it. Screen, disable it.
Yeah, thank you. So in the case of this In the case of this conventional structure, what happens is this profile weight would be very huge. When you're just adding such kind of a standard profile to this structure, especially when we have a long spans, if you use such kind of a things, the weight of the structure will become very huge. So that's why we wanted to make a very thin section, and this should also be having very less weight. For such conditions, we have to go to the pre-engineering buildings. In the sense, we will be just shaping the profiles based on the thicknesses of the plates. We'll have a so-and-so 8mm thickness and so-and-so. So now what we do is, once we design this structure, whatever the profile that is requiring, such kind of a profiles will be now manufactured. Not that we are using the standard profiles which are existing in the market, right? So we'll get so-and-so depth and so-and-so width, so-and-so thicknesses. Right? Those might not be matching with the standard profiles. Now we will take this, whatever the profile is required for it, we'll take this profile and we will give this profile details to a PEB manufacturer. So they will just create, I mean, they'll manufacture such kind of a profiles, and we will use those profiles. So when we use these profiles, what happens is we are effectively utilizing these thicknesses, and then of course we are controlling the weight of the structure. Controlling weight of the structure is more important in the case of a pre-engineering structures, especially when we have very long spans. So that is what is pre-engineered. Pre-engineered in the sense, what are the profile we get from the analysis and the design? We will take this profile and give it to a manufacturer. According to that, manufacturer will prepare a profile. And then when to prefer? It is very obvious, when we have very long spans, it is always advisable to go ahead with this pre-engineering structures. Comparison, we have understood the comparison. Comparison in the sense, for shorter span pieces, we can use this normal or rolled steel sections. And then advantages, when you can prefer, and when you can just go ahead with this pre-engineering concepts, or when we get, or when we use only the standard profiles, when we use the profiles which are effectively being used in the case of the design, and then we can almost control the cost around the 30%. So we can reduce the cost of the structure around the 30% when you use this pre-engineered profiles. Then, now we understand what is this PEB and when to prefer it is clear. And then we know the comparison between these two and when to use and where to use. We know the advantage also that indirectly we can reduce 30% of cost. And next thing is how to design. This is all okay, then how to design this. So this is what is a PEB structure. See here, I have a column here. Of course, I also have a column here, right? These two are the columns, and this is the profile here. And if you can just see this profile here, the thickness of the profile at the top is very huge. The same thickness of the profile has been, when depth of this profile is here is very huge, but the depth of the profile at the base of the column is reduced. So do you find this kind of things in the case of a conventional steel structures? No. In the case of a conventional steel structure, you'll have a uniform depth of this member. We'll have a uniform depth. But now what we are doing is, according to the analytical resultants, in the sense, according to the Bendemann diagram. So have you ever seen this kind of a Bendemann diagram? You must be knowing this Bendemann diagram for a pin to support. Let me just, anyways. So if I can just keep like here one pin to connection, and here also one pin to connection, and the loads are applied, it is very obvious that we'll get a minimum in the sense we get only zero bending moment at this bottom point, base point, and we'll get the maximum bending moment at the top. So that kind of a bending moment, in the sense, whatever we get the shape of the bending moment, accordingly we are getting the profile, and the same profile details will be given to a manufacturer, and then make that profile and give it to us. Then we are indirectly, just to see how effectively we are utilizing this material here, there are two advantages. One is we are controlling this material, which eventually controls the weight of the structure also. So both of this we have advantages. And this one is called cranes, where we can just lift the heavy weights. We can use this lift heavy weights, and we can just move from here to here. And this is what is called a bracket. This is what is called a bracket. And this is what is called gantry girders. So these are things that you are going to study from your academics. And see what is the advantage of these ones, these lines are called side girds. So if we can make this kind of a side girds to this column, then we can just connect the sheet to it. If you don't have these kind of a side girds, you cannot keep this sheet connected to these columns. because every element, in the sense, it can be a sheet, it can be this kind of a side guard, it can be this kind of a cross bracing, or it can be a column, it can be this profile, anything. For everything, there is a limitation. Limitation to the length. Length in the words, right? So in the case of the sheeting, we do not provide more than 1.5 meters width of the sheeting. So that's why for every 1.5 meters, they'll have this kind of side guards here, and also even here also. These are all called purlins. So purlin to purlin, we can connect with the sheet. Again, purlin to purlin, connect with the sheet. So we can cover this entire structure. So this is the better example, or we can say this picture is clearly showing how this PAB building would be looking like. And this one is called U height, and this is called U strut. This one is called U strut. All these components now we will see in the next slides. So this is a real road section. See, this is a PAB section, this is a road section. Here, if you can see, these are all the very road sections, in the sense, you know, this is the ISMB column, and this ISMB again. We are just connecting with this profiles, this angle sections, right? It is called lacing system. This is called lacing system that you are going to study from your academics now in the next academic semesters. So here, see, this is one again. When you compare with this, so we have a column like this. So we have two columns. We are getting connected with these two columns by introducing these kind of a angle profiles, angles. When you go to this, see, we have only locally provided bracket condition. We have locally provided bracket here. So here, see, we are maintaining this kind of a huge column from bottom to top to bottom, just to support this kind of a gantry girder. See here, there's only one small bracket. And moreover, here, see, there is a very huge truss. We are maintaining this kind of a height, and there is a n number of members which are getting connected to each other. So here, we have only one profile. Only one profile, that's all. Only one profile, there are no other angle sections here. So this is what roller sections building, or you can say convention steel building. And see, now we understand what this PAB is, what is the comparison, what is the advantage, and now we started discussing about how to design this structure. And before designing this structure, we have seen some of the pictures. From there, we can slightly understand the difference between these two, like convention steel structure and then PAB steel structure. So from this is PAB steel structures. Now we need to understand the component names. See here, these are all called, this one is called steel portal frame, you can say. This is called a steel portal frame, and you can say it's a gable wall, and this one is called end post spacing. This is end post spacing. This one is called end post. This is also end post. This is called corner post. Again, this is a corner post. This is a side wall. Here we would have a side wall, and this one is called a base spacing. From frame to frame, spacing is called base spacing. And we can have, this is a rod bracing. We are using a rod bracing. We might be using the bracing concepts like angles in the case of a conventional steel, but in the case of the PAB structures, it is simply a kind of a rod will be connected to this with a very huge span. For this huge length, we use this kind of small bracings, rod bracings. And then wall gut, nothing but side gut. I told you, this is a gut. And this is what is called EU height. EU height, wall system, wall guts, rod bracing, and this distance is called base spacing, and this is what is called a side wall, this is a clear height, and this is what is called rafter, this is what is called end post, and these two are called corner post, right? And this one is called roof purlin, this one is called purlins, these purlins are called roof purlins, right? And this one is ridge point, and this is called roof system, this is entirely roof system. So these are the components of the PAB structure. Once we are familiar with the components of this PAB structure, now we have to understand that all components, in the sense our structural components, are not the same one. So here we use a rod. Here we have used one different type of column profile. Here we use a different type of rafter. And here what we are using, this purlin, is not the same material that we are going to use for this. This roof purlin shape is different. Material grade is different. Material specification itself is different, right? And here we are using this again sheet. Again, we have a doubt on sheet. What kind of a sheet is this? What is this thickness? And how long will it be there? Means life of this structure. What is the material specification? So what I'm trying to tell you is, not every component of the building will have a same material specification. Each and every component will have a different specification, unlike RCC structure, right? So now this is a cross section of one profile. So this is what is called a portal frame. This one is called a portal frame. And we know this is a leaf sheeting, and this is eave strut, and this one is called purlin. This is purlin to purlin, and there is a spacing. Means this inclination is there now. We have a wrapped inclination. This inclination usually be 1 in 10. Usually this inclination will be 1 in 10. This one is ridgeline. This one is called eave side, and this one is called eave strut. And the spacing here usually will be left like 1.1 meters or 1100. Usually purlin to purlin distance would not be more than 1.5 meters because of sheet of comment width and sheet width. And even here also, this one we have a side gut here, even side gut distance also, since it is also supporting this sheet width would be again limited to 1.5 meters. So this is a completely a practical information which might not be available from our academics. So these kind of limitations are always there when you are entering into this industrial field. So what else is left here? So here we can see it is a finished floor level and remaining one, fine. So this is what is called width of the building, or you can even say span. So in this case, we are just going to discuss about a very huge building. Like the length of this building is almost 117 meters. The dimension might not be clear here. However, I'll show you the dimensions in the next slide. And then width of this building is almost 45 meters here. And this is the side elevation. See here, we have a kind of a windows. These are not a window, so this will be used like we can say these are all called like perforated sheets. You can say perforated sheets. From this, you can get the ventilated sheets also. You'll get some lighting from this. And these are all the doors, side doors we have here. Right? When we have a side doors here, what we have to understand is when wind is acting on this surface. When wind is acting on the surface, obviously since we have openings and also windows here, obviously wind will enter into this building. So wind load analysis in the case of the PEB structure is more complicated. In the case of the PEB structures, wind load analysis is more complicated. You can also make a note that you have to pay much more attention when you are studying about application of wind or calculation of wind loads, when you are designing a truss or when you are designing any kind of industrial building. You can make a note here. You have to pay more attention when you are studying in the next semester. So this is a cross section. This is a previously we have a plan and of course side elevation here, and here we have a cross section. So we have a turbo winds here. So from this turbo winds, since we have very huge height, like 12 meters, sometimes 16 meters also. When we have this kind of huge height, so this the kind of a turbo manipulators will extract this kind of acting like a exhaust fans. We can say exhaust fans, right? This will act like exhaust fans. As here this is a gutter in the sense when rain comes, this entire rainwater will go to the left side, and of course it will go on the right side also. Finally, this rainwater which is collected at this corner will be transferred to this gutter. From gutter to end of this structure, or maybe at intermediate portion, again there will be a vertical down pipes. You can just look at here, we have a down pipe. So water will come here through this down pipes, and again we'll have a small side drain here, and this entire water will be collected to this small drain, and then finally will be drained out. So here it is mentioned like FFL, which means finished floor level, and the span from here to here is almost 45 meters, and of course we have a intermediate column here, so which means it is 22.5 here. From here to here it is 22.5. Of course, even without making this kind of intermediate support, we can design this structure for complete 45 meters span also. But since it is not necessary to maintain a complete, it is not really necessary to have a 45 meters span without intermediate columns, we have introduced one intermediate columns, so which automatically controls the weight of this roof also, this profile, this portal frame. So which controls this, which controls the weight of the structure, and we can use a small profile only, which eventually make structure more stable and economical. Core books that we need to refer are here, like dead load. For dead loads, we need to verify this ISA 875 part 1, and then for live load part 2, for wind loads part 3, and earthquake load 1893 part 1. And then these are the core books for loading conditions, means when you want to apply the loads on it, or type of the load that you need to consider, you have to verify all these types of the core books. and then code books for design. So these are for loading and these are for design. What are the code books to be verified? And if you want to take a screenshot of it, you can please take this. You can take a screenshot of this one also. If it is, of course, it is more important, you can take the screenshot. Thank you. So here, code books for design. So these are for the load applications or load calculations, right? We have to take the loads from the, by verifying all these code books depending on the type of load, like dead load, this one, live load, this one. For wind load, 875 part 3. For earthquake load, 1893 part 1. Now we need to design this structure, taking the guidelines given on this code book, like IS 800 2007 LSD, which means limit state design. And then here we mention like mainframe in the sense column and then rafters are the mainframes, and then purlins and then side runners. We have discussed, no? So these are all the purlins. This is a purlin and then side runners. This purlins and side runners not exactly the same profiles that we are using for column and then rafter. So column and then rafter are very used members compared to the remaining other elements, and this is why this is called mainframe, and the remaining components are called secondary members. So purlins and then runners are secondary members, you can say. So for those kind of secondary members, we have to use this code book IS 801 1975 to design them. And then for deflection criteria, of course, you can use the same code book IS 800 2007. And the material specification, what kind of the material that we need to use, especially grades of materials. Like you can see primary members like frame, columns and then rafters of the primary member. For this, we have to go through this code book. IS 2062 is the code book. So from there we have a grade of steel like 350, ER 350 grade, and ordinary strength is around 490. So this is the grade of steel for frame that we can use. And secondary members, bracing and one second, please. I'm sorry. For secondary members, you can take like bracing, and then secondary members nothing but a bracing, and then secondary members like purlins and then side runners. For those also, you can take 2052 is the code book, but material specification like grade is only ER 250, which means this is lesser strength, and the ultimate strength is 410. So in addition to these primary members and secondary members, we also have the connections. Connections means these connections will be done by bolts. So these kind of bolts will be used for different types of the connections, like splicing cases, splice bolts. Class is A.8, HSFG means high strength friction grip bolts. High strength friction grip bolts, HSFG means. So for this, we have again special code book like 3757. And then for purlins and girds, not really it is required high strength bolts. So that is why almost half of the strength has been reduced. So here it is 8.8. So 8.8 denotes like yield strength. And then this 8.8 is nothing but 80% of this yield strength will be considered as a working stress, we can see. And even here also 4.6 is mentioned. Then here it is nothing but 60% we are considering the strength of this 400 yield strength, right? And for this, the code book is changed, like 1367. And for anchor bolts, you have to take this code book like 2062 only, and grade is mentioned like 250A. So unlike RCC structures, we have n number of grades, n number of specification, n number of profiles, n number of load cases, n number of load combinations. The analysis would also be slightly complicated when we compare with this RCC structures. So what I am saying is, I am not saying it is very difficult, but only thing is, you just have to just go through these kind of things so that certainly will have a very huge weightage for you in the market. So and of course, after you are done with your education, it is very obvious, either you may go for next higher educations or you may go for a job. So when you just go ahead with the same conventional procedure or conventional skills, ordinary skills that you develop, it is very tough. It is very tough to get into the industry. So you need to improve yourself, especially at the areas where it is more complicated to others. So best advantage is, if you can really concentrate on steel structures, trust me, you'll get a job very quickly compared to others. because learning or understanding this history structure would be definitely a great advent, a great boom for you. So pay more attention towards this. I'm not saying to ignore the remaining things, but I'm saying that there is a very huge demand for it. Now, dozen assumptions in the sense main rafter and then columns are rigidly connected. In the sense main rafter is a beam, you can see, and the columns are rigidly connected to each other. And then column base is pinned. So other assumption is column base is pinned connection. So on height of this column is 10 to 12 meters only. Means you can assume pinned base, pinned connection, pinned base when we have a height of building like 10 to 12 meters only. When the height of the structure is more than 12 meters, then if you can just use the pinned connection, then this would be very lean or slender member, and then it will be automatically failed during the erection stage itself, not after the structure is constructed. Never ever think that structure will be collapsed and the structure will be damaged after it has been completely constructed or erected. It is not like that. So there will be n number of occasions during even the execution or during this erection of the structure. Also, there are n number of possibilities that structure will be failed. So that's why you have to always think. You always have to think every aspect from the beginning of erection of this building to the beginning of erection of building to this wholly constructed or wholly fully erected this structure. And then lateral stability of this structure, in the sense, lateral stability. Lateral stability in the sense, structure should be very stable. One second, please. So let me say I have a structure like this, right? I have a structure like this. So when it is acting in this direction, this should be very stable. This should not go like this, right? This should not go like this. So lateral stability. So what are the things that we are going to add to give lateral stability to this frame? Lateral stability of the structure is provided by portal action, portal frame action. In the sense, we are not giving this kind of a wounded truss. We are using this portal frame action is nothing but we are providing the very huge rafters here and then here. And the lateral stability in the sense, we have a building like, let me say we have a building like this full length, right? Now this building also, when the wind is acting in this direction, obviously this building also just try to deflect this way or drift this way, right? So how are you going to control this direction? This direction anyway, we are saying we are providing this due to this portal action. In a sense, I'm keeping the column depth like this, right? Column depth like this and like this when wind is acting like this. If you can just keep the column like this, right? When wind is acting this way, so trust me, this is not having enough stability or this is not having enough stiffness. Stiffness is there, but we are not effectively utilizing the stiffness in this case. And that's why most of the occasions you will see the column orientations like this only in the case of steel structures. You don't see like this column, especially for PEP structures. Because when we have a huge span, and if you change the orientation like this, there is no section modulus. You can say Z value, or if you want to understand it very clearly, you can say I only. I means moment of inertia, right? So if I have a section like this, IXX, you can say, right? You can say IXX is equal to BD cube by 12, right? How about a Y direction, in other direction, DB cube by 12. So here in this case, D is very smaller. In this case, D is very huge. So D is having again cubic root, right? So this strength will be very high. So that's why we have to keep this column orientation this direction, so that we are using this stiffness of the element very effectively. Yeah, I think I'm becoming very familiar with this Google Meet options. Yeah, so what we are saying is we are trying to look into every component of a structure and making sure that those are stable and safe. Right, now it is done. Now it is stably, roof purlins are continuous beams supported on rafters. So we are assuming that it is acting like a continuous member. So sometimes what happened is purlin to purlin, in the sense from one portal frame to another portal frame, we'll keep only purlin and then we'll take one more purlin and then connect to this. So which means it is acting like a simply supported. Instead of that, you can just keep only one purlin whose length may be around 12 meters. You just run like this. You have just 12 meters length of piece and you can keep on three columns. Again, joint it, again, you can keep remaining 12 meters. But we are doing like this, which means it is a continuous members. Side purlins are also, side runners are continuous beams supported on columns. Now the dimensions of this structure are given like here. So length of the building is like 120 meters. Just imagine 120 meters. And width of the building is 43 meters. Height is 10.5 meters. Rafter spacing is 6 meters. And then corner spacing is also 6 meters. And then purlin spacing is anyway 1.5. Cut spacing is 1.5 most of the occasions. You don't find a major change between these two. Like purlin spacing would be the same. Cut spacing would be the same. Roof slope would be the same. Most of the occasions, these values would be very same for any kind of a PEP structure. But this might change. Column to column spacing might be 6 meters or sometimes it can be 7.5 meters also. Usually not more than 7.5 meters. If you go more than 7.5 meters, practically structure would become very uneconomical and not even sure. I mean, also sometimes fails in the stability. These are the geometric details of the PEP structure. So dead loads nothing but the weight of the element or the weight of the elements on the loads which are completely fixed. So nothing but self weight of the all members, columns, beams. You can say columns, beams, purlins, sheeting, and then again side sheeting, rod bracing, side girds, and all these components of self weight is dead load only. And then roof sheeting 25 kg per square meters. So weight of this roof sheeting is like this. We are not going to make model of sheeting in our STAT Pro. That's why whatever the components which are not being modeled in the STAT Pro, those loads have to be manually calculated and apply on it. Purlins 5 kg per square meters, and then collateral loads nothing but hung loads is nothing but I can say yes, for example, I have a column here, I have one more column here, and I have a roof slope like this, right? So there would be some kind of a, you can say fans, or you can say some kind of any electrical equipments here. So there would be this kind of a supports, right? So these kind of additional support loads are called collateral loads or hung loads, right? And sheeting is, anyway, we have a sheeting here. So this is a sheeting load. And purling is, anyway, we have a purling like this. One purling and the purling. So purling load here. Purling weight is here. And then live load. So there is a possibility that we can have a live load also on this structure. So we have to take the load according to this angle of inclination. One second, please. Now we understand these loads. Next thing is wind loads. For wind loads, we have to refer this code book IS 875.3, and for finding out the design wind pressure. So wind pressure that is going to act on roof and also on the side walls can be estimated by using this formula, right? So this formula is like this. Yeah. So this one, the formula, and VZ is nothing but here. So VZ equal like this, VB into K1 into K2 into K3. VB is equal to basic speed, and then K1 is nothing but property factor or risk coefficient, which is depending on the life of the structure. How long you want to have this structure, whether it is for 5 years or for 25 years or 50 years. And then K2 is the terrain factor, where the structure is located, whether it is located in a hilly areas or on a flat, this one. Sorry, it is about the topography factor. And here, terrain factor and then height factor. Terrain factor and height factor is depending on the size of the building. And of course, the size of the building and where the building is located. For example, if you are making this kind of a 3EB structure in outskirts, where it is a complete open space, then the effect of the wind will be very huge. If you are conducting the same thing, maybe in the middle of the city, since n number of buildings are already existing next to this PEB structure, the impact of the wind would not be much affecting our structure. So based on this criteria, we have to find out this VZ, and from VZ we have to just substitute here to get this PZ value. So let me say this wind speed, basic wind speed would be around 50 meter per second, which is of course depending on the location, but in a coastal zone usually will have a 50 meter per second as a wind speed, and we know this length of the building like 120 meters. Based on this, so this we have to find out this pressure. So here there are clauses like, you can take class like table number 4 and 5. So here it is mentioned like wind load. Wind load shall be as per this 875.3, basic wind speed is 50. For calculation of wind speed, the following coefficients shall be applied, like K1 value is finally 1. And then we are considering the how much period, it is for 50 years. And then K2, terrain factor, height, and so on. So from this table 2, and we are considering this and based on this category, in the sense whether the length of the structure is less than 20 meters or 20 to 50 meters or more than 50 meters likewise. And then finally, topography factor. Topo means land, graphy means description, how the land is there, which means whether the structure is located on hilly zone areas, or it is being constructed on erected on a flat ground. So according to that, you have to take most of the occasions, it will be only one. And finally, we can get this VZ formula like this. This VZ formula is here only. And once you get VZ, you introduce this, and then you'll get design wind pressure. So once you get this design wind pressure, now you can just focus. See, unlike this RCC structure, in this case, what happens is you don't straight away take only wind pressure. Now you need to take this wind pressure, and you have to take this. Not that entire wind pressure is going to act on a single solid face. There are openings to this building, right? So we have a doors and the windows also existing on the face of the car, face of the building. So that's why we have to now introduce pressure coefficients, right? CPE means external pressure coefficient. CPI means internal pressure coefficient. So we have to take this internal pressure coefficient and external pressure coefficient, and then A is nothing but effective area where wind is acting. And then PD is nothing but design wind pressure that we have estimated from this. Nothing but PZ, no? We have estimated from this. And then here, external pressure coefficient, internal pressure coefficient, surface area of the structural element, and then design wind pressure. And now we can go to this external pressure coefficients like walls and then buildings with a medium and then large openings. So there are again two things here for external pressure coefficients. Like we have walls also, and also buildings with medium to large openings, right? So it is not necessary, I mean, it is depending on the permeability or the percentage of openings. See here, buildings with medium and the large openings may also exhibit either positive or negative internal pressure depending on the direction of the wind. Buildings with medium openings, between about 5 to 10% of wall area. So there might be openings like windows and the doors. So that percentage, I mean that area divided by wall surface area will give us the permeability in the form of percentage. It can be 5% or 20, it can be 5 to 20%. So it is 5 to 20%, now we can take internal pressure coefficients. Like internal pressure coefficients are always constant only. Constant in the sense, it can be when you have a percentage of opening like 5 to 20%, it is like 0.5, plus 0.5 and then minus 0.5. That's it. Internal pressure coefficients 0.5, and later with an internal pressure coefficient minus 0.5, means you have to first take this plus 0.5 and again you have to take this minus 0.5. And then buildings with large openings means if you have a doors and n number of doors and n number of windows and that opening area is more than 20%, you have to take this CPI value. This value we can take this one 0.7 or minus 0.7 if you have a this opening is more than 20%. Otherwise, you'll take 0.5 and then minus 0.5. Then you have openings of around 5 to 20%. Now we know what is this PZ, that means PD, which is design wind pressure that we have discussed for the previous slide. And we also know this A, which means this is effective area, right? Let me say I have a building like this, right? I have a building like this. This is a side wall, right? And we have a like this. We have like this, right? This is the wind. This is the face. So I have to take like this is a door, and here also I have a door or something, right? So what I do is I'll take this area, entire area, right? I know this area now. I know this area. I know what is this PD. I need to know find out this one and this one. External pressure and internal pressure coefficient. I can take this internal pressure coefficient by considering this permeability or percentage of openings. And now it is the time for us to take this external pressure coefficient. See here, now we have all these things like dead load, single roof. This is the sheeting load, 25 kg per square meters, and then purlin loans, anyway, we have not considered here, including purlin loans, and sheeting is considered as 20, and total dead load is like 25 kg per square meters. Collateral load, nothing but hang loads or hung loads. So that is 25 kg per square meters, and the lime load, usually for the trusses, would be 75 kg per square meters only. 75 kg per square meters. When you just check all these loads, like dead loads and then collateral load and then lime load, all these loads are very insignificant compared to the loads that are usually acting in a RCC structure. RCC structure will find very huge loads. In the case of steel structures, these loads are very nominal loads. So from this statement, we can conclude the vertical loads that are transferring from structure are very lesser, right? It is very lesser. So that is why we have to be much more concerned or careful about the connections, because now the load is very lesser and there are possibilities to lose its connections easily. So that is why the connections boards are having high grade, like 8.8 grade or 4.6 grades, right? And then that is why you can also notice the foundation design. When you design the foundation or when you check the foundation sizes for this kind of steel buildings, you will definitely laugh at it, because those core foundation sizes will be like 1.2 meters or 1.5 meters by 1.5 meters. But when it comes to the RCC structures, foundation size will be very huge. Now we know this window load, we know this window pressure, and we know the clear height of this structure also known to us, which is 10.5. And then total length of the building is 120, and this comes under class C. And then from this we are getting the factors K1 this, K2 is this, K3 is this, and then K1, K2, K3, and then this one. Finally, we'll get the pressure like 148 kg per square meter, or we can say 1.5 kilonewton per square meter. 1.5 kilonewton per square meter is the maximum wind load. I mean, maximum in the sense, it can be a maximum load compared to the other loads in the case of this PEB structure. But 1.5 kilonewton per square meter or 150 kg per square meter in the case of the RCC buildings is too negligible. Yeah, now you can see this, we have a roof slope, it is like 5.7 only. This roof is called on A side and this one is called B side, and up to 2.5 meters we are keeping RCC wall, because yes, up to 2.5 meters you need to keep RCC wall, because here you can keep doors. You don't just keep the doors or provide the door to the sheeting. You have to maintain RCC, I mean brick walls up to at least a 10 feet at 1 feet. So after this one will have a doors and then windows also. So what is the use if you can keep one door here, I mean one window here? You have a column steel, this is the height of the structure is 10.5 and width is this much, right? This one is called A side roof and this one is called B side roof. Sorry. Yeah, now from this, as we just have stopped in the previous case, because we know what is this CPE minus CPI, CPE now minus CPI into P into pressure into area, right? We know pressure, we know area, we know in this one. We have to now find out this one. For finding out this CPE, it is slightly this one, calculus are involved in it. So let me say I have a building like A, B, C, D, right? And this width is 45 meters and this length of this building is 120 meters, right? This 120 and this 45. Now from this plan dimensions and also from the height of this structure, you have to select the table from this code book, from where it will start getting this CPE values. So H by W, height by width, this much, which is meeting this requirement. L by W, length by W, length is how much? 120. W, width is how much? 45. What is that value? 2.67. So it is now satisfying this requirement. Once you can find out these two, according to that, you'll go to this table and then you'll get these values, right? Like say left value, what is this value? 0.7. Left one means this one. Sorry. All right, see here. This is now, this is A, B, right? Left wall is nothing but this one. Right wall is nothing but second one. Right, back wall is nothing but this one, and then front wall is nothing but this one. Right, we know what is this A, B, C, D now, and then roof A, roof B, we know it because we have seen in the previous slide, like this is A and this is B. Now, once we get this from this, based on this, I'll go to the table, and from the table, you'll get these factors like CPE values. So once I get this CPE, CPE is only the parameter that we have, about which we have not yet discussed. Once we get this parameter, now I can get the pressure. Now I can get the force and apply on individual components. From this, finally, see here, it is also mentioned the CPI value we are considering is 5 to 20% is permeability or openings. This factor is plus or minus 0.5. So now I need to add once plus to this, again take minus to this, again plus to this, minus to this, plus to this, minus to this, plus to this, minus to this. Likewise, you will get n number of factors. So likewise, see here, left wall, right wall, back wall, front wall, left side of roof and then right side roof. Now here we are seeing like internal positive pressure. So for zero direction, in the sense I have a building like this, I have a building. This is 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, again 360. So for zero direction, you have to take CPI value like positive 0.5. Again, you take negative 0.5. So positive 0.5 for 0 degrees is this one. And then negative 0.0 degrees is this one. And then 90 degrees positive 0.1, this one. And then 180 degrees negative degrees, I mean positive negative to this one. Again, 180 degrees to this one, positive, and 180 degrees negative to this one. 270 degrees positive CPA to this one, again negative to this one. Right? Likewise, we have got all these factors. Now, once I got all these factors, now I can use these factors and multiply with the pressure and then area to get force. Yeah, this is the table. Finally, we have arrived. So what we are now discussing is, we are just discussing how to calculate the wind loads on this structure. See here, now from this table, we are getting all these force and we can apply on this structure. Yeah, once we apply the loads and the loads here, we need to now look into the load combinations. Combinations for which we can take this table for IS-800-2007. And for limit state of strength and the limit state of serviceability. You would have seen this limit state of strength and serviceability. We have seen the first slide now, design flow chart. Structural components should have enough strength and should also be satisfying this serviceability criteria, nothing but deflections. And then strength criteria, and then leading, and then accompanying. Right? We have a loads like dead load, live load, and then CL means crane load. Dead load plus live load plus crane load plus either wind load or atypical load. And this case, dead load, wind load, dead load, either wind load or atypical load. And dead load, either this one, which means erection loads, right? Likewise, we have to take the combination from this table. Here we can take the combination from this table and then apply it, right? Now from this, like earthquake, here we have earthquake loads. We have to take the earthquake loads from this, like this is of course dealing with this wind pressure only. Here seismic loads, we have to verify this code book. You have to verify this code book. Accordingly, you need to take like zone factors this much, and then importance factors like 1.5, response reduction factors like 5, and then underside of the column plate, RCC pedestal height is 0.3 meters. Likewise, in the sense, you need to take verify this code book 1893-2002, and then take this seismic parameters accordingly, and then find them and design it. So, in the case of this steel structure, once again, I will stressing a lot or emphasizing a lot to focus more on wind load calculations. Calculating this earthquake load, earthquake might be looking like very interesting or might be looking like very dynamic thing. But trust me, in the case of steel structures, wind loads are more complicated. Wind loads, calculation of wind loads is more complicated. So now you go to this load combinations. So according to that, we will now design this structure. Yeah, we'll go to this next, other criteria. So other criteria is like framework shall be robust, and then self-supporting structure, and then PE rigid frame comprises columns and then rafters as per design. So whatever we have initially discussed about the assumptions, those assumptions are now slightly elaborated. Grid slabs should not be used for resisting horizontally. I mean, whatever the assumptions, see, all these are the assumptions only. Framework, let me say, start with the first one. Framework should be robust and self-support, right? When we have erected this column and then wrapped and then again another columns, this should be self-supporting. We should not give any additional support during this erection to this column, this frame. And then PEB rigid frame comprises the columns and then, what we are saying is it is a rigid frame. We are considering this as a rigid frame concept only. And then grade slab shall not be used. In a sense, we'll have a slab here. So what we are saying is this slab is not going to give any kind of a stiffness to this structure. It's not taking any horizontal forces. Don't take that. So that is the assumption. All weldings shall be continuous. Stitch weld shall not be allowed. So there should be a kind of a welding, continuous welding in a sense. So if I have a, let me say, I have a I section like this. This is the depth, this is like this, right? So stitch welding is continuous welding in the sense, this is the web line, no? This is the web line. So continuous welding in the sense, this entire web, this length will be completely welded like this. Stitch welding in the sense, here you'll have a welding here, and the other side will have a welding. After leaving a gap, we'll have a welding on other side. Means we'll weld, gap, weld, gap, weld, gap, weld, gap, weld, gap. This is what is called stitch welding. What here is saying, don't take such kind of build, stitch welding concepts. That is what here the criteria is. No hollow section shall be used unless access is available for maintenance and painting. Don't use any kind of a hollow sections, very clear. Deflection shall be as per code, very clear. Sag rods should be provided for purlins if necessary. Sag rod is nothing but, I can show you the pictures. You just remember it, I can show you the pictures. And then side lap sheeting is around 50 mm, and then end lap should be 150 mm, right? I can show you all these details in the pictures. Roof slab, roof slope would be around 1 in 10 only, and here roof sheeting shall be provided in a manner which prevents ingress of rainwater. In the sense, okay, when rain comes, whatever the droplets are there, droplets should not come the holes where we are providing the holes. Silicon sealant tape shall be used for all joints with self-tapping screws and rivets. So there should be a tape that you have to just connect to this so that this would be completely covering this joint. Self-drilling screws shall be of IWDX build. So there is a grade for this, that is ITW buildings with the EPDM washer and the equivalent make. Means here they are talking much more in detail about the specification of the material, what kind of material it can be. So here, see, primary steel specifications are given. It's primary steel is like all primary members like column, roof, portal beams or roof trusses. Bracing should be in structural steel. Conforming to this code, grade is this much and then code book is this. ASTM 572 grade. Grade 50 or IS 2062 means either using this American standards or using this Indian standards. Grade would be around 350. The yield strength of the material shall be 345. Means for main members, we are using high strength only. The structural steel members shall be made up with the belt up sections using the thickness of. Belt up sections means, as I told you, according to the requirement, we create or we ask manufacturer to create such kind of a members. And however, the thickness of should not be less than 5 mm. The main objective or aim of the spring engineering building is to reduce the thicknesses and to use this profiles very effectively. When your goal is to reduce the weight and then this one, increase the stiffness, don't just take the thickness of the element less than 5 mm. There is again a restriction here. And the building should be designed according with these codes. Okay. Yes, we have seen this plan and section of warehouse. And then you can see the cross section. Yeah, now I'll just show you how the straight fire will be. This is all completely about this design. I can show you, sorry. Yeah, this is what the same strand foil about which we have been discussing. See here. Thank you. See, this is how we can design this structure using StatPro software. See how beautiful it is looking like. Of course, it is more complicated also. See, these are all call. These are all the calls. This is corner post and this is central post. Central post and these are all called corner post columns. And this is what is called sag rods. So you can see this kind of a small cross ones, right? Cross members. These cross members are called sag rods. And these are all this main, these members are called purlins. And this is called rafter. This is called rafter. And there is a kind of a cantilever. One second. So this is what is called, like it is looking like a cantilever portion, right? When vehicles comes here, when vehicles come and then when they start unloading it, when rain comes, it should not be just, I mean, this has to be covered, right? When rains and this has to be covered. That is why there is a kind of a cantilever position provided here. When vehicle comes, then it is okay. Vehicle comes and then automatically unload this material without creating any damage. So this is how it is looking like in the StatPro. And I can show you some of the drawings here. Yeah, this is the drawing here. So see this drawing. See, I told you now even the detailing is also very tough in the case of the steel structures. See, we have C1, C2 columns, and this again PC means we have central columns here, and we have again columns here. So here we have a rolling shutter. I told you now, those means rolling shutters. Here we have a rolling shutter here, and then you can see this, all of these things. And there are the connections. See, all connections are like this. This one, and then this one, and then this one. Bolt details. See how complicated it is? Everything like washer plate, diameter, OD means outer diameter, thickness, this ID means internal diameter. It is a 4 thickness. Don't say it should not be less than 5 mm. It is a washer plate, not the steel, main steel component. So see, everything is very, see how complicated or how micro level of details are required for executing this kind of a PEB structure. See here, see, I can show you some of the pictures also. I'm going to show you some more drawings. See here, see these are the column types, these are all the columns here, see. Level plate, thicknesses, member profile, index number like 1, 1, and then this is 2. FLG means flange plate sizes. Web plate thickness is this one, and the material grade as per this code book, and the grade is like 350E, right? Such kind of a wonderful specification, wonderful each and every detail has to be certainly mentioned on the drawings. Then only this will be, that will be convenient for the contractor to execute it or to erect these buildings. See here, sometimes pipes are used, somewhere channels are used, angles are used, sag rods are used, jet purlins are used. See, jet purlins. Again, this kind of a C shape is used, right? This wrong, this not the iron. It's not the iron, see, it is galvanized. Again, material is now changed. They're all the galvanized, this one galvanized, galvanized, galvanized material. So what I'm saying is, as I have mentioned 1 hour before, so everything that what you are studying in the theory, maybe from this strength of materials, structure analysis, design of steel structures, all of this entire theoretical concepts would be very effectively utilized in the case of a steel structures designs. That is how it is looking like. So I can just go to one more picture. I can now show you some of the pictures here. It will be much more interesting to you. So these are the code books we have, and then brochures. Sorry, I should have. Yeah, see here. This is one of the building that we designed. See how those people are just erecting this column. See where this guy is sitting. See this very huge column. See very huge column. Where this guy is here. See what is this depth? Very huge. You cannot get a kind of a standard rolled sections with this very huge dimensions. This is one of the picture. I can show you this. So this is what is called stiffener plates, and this is what is called base plate, and these bolts are called anchor bolts. These are anchor bolts, and underneath this here you have to keep like a grouting. You have to keep a material kind of a material which is like grouting, and this is what is called pedestal. See here, every bolt, it is not easy to find out the center of the bolts. When the people are ready with this column, then if there is any possibility that hole of the bolt is not exactly with the bolt location, then that is tough. How can you just break everything? So it is, everything has to be done at a micro level. See what kind of equipment is being used here. See, these profiles are very huge profiles. Here we did not use this kind of a here we use the uniform sections, because here in this case we have a very huge crane loads acting on it, so that's why we did not maintain tapered sections. We use the uniform sections only. See, this is what is called side gut. And see how these people are connecting to this. This is galvanized material. So see, these are all galvanized. See, very huge area. All columns are erected. This is a pedestal, and this is a pile cap. This one is pile cap. See, now the column is being erected. See, this guy is holding this, and this guy will slide. This guy will slightly operate it and finally place here exactly on this. When he is trying to place here, he just move with his hand, and then finally try to place exactly within the places of the bolts. See, there are all the materials which are ready, and this is jet type. See, this is called a jet type purlin. This is a conventional steel. Yeah, that's all about it. Structure drawing, we have seen everything we have done. Now if you have any questions, you can just let me know, or otherwise I'll just announce something. Yeah, any questions from your end, please? Any questions from your end? I think I need to go to this one now.
Sir, good afternoon.
Yeah, very good afternoon.
Sir, the use of tapered column profiles in the PEB allows charge to reduce the horizontal shear tolerance.
Pardon, what is that?
It's a use of a tapered column sections in PEB.
Yeah.
Will have the chance in reduction of horizontal shear tolerance.
Not really horizontal shear here. So you can also just verify this academics when you are designing any kind of a columns, even in RCC structures also. You do not check
for shear. In case of seismic occurrence, I'm asking in case of seismic.
Even in the seismic also, what I told is effect of loads, especially effect of wind loads, will be very huge in the case of steel structures. Even the earthquake also won't be affecting much, because the structure is completely lightweight structures. Where we have very seismic, in the sense it is not the load which is going to happen from somewhere else. So with the entire loads, dead loads and live loads, which are acting in the structure, which are originally acting downwards, will now change its direction to the horizontal, and that amount is depending on the seismic coefficient. And that seismic quotient is depending on various factors, right? Indirectly, what I'm trying to tell you is dead loads and the live loads which are acting on this steel structure are very minimum. So now this minimum loads are going to be multiplied with the seismic quotient, which finally becomes again less. So that's why impact of earthquake forces, dead loads and live loads on steel structures would be always lesser. but impact of Windows will be very huge. So now your question is, what you are saying is reduction of, you mean using this tapered section would be satisfying this shear force criteria, right?
Yes.
Is this correct?
This is
your question.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
so what I'm saying, even if you can take your statement into the consideration, we have to certainly check each and everything, and then only we have to arrive at such kind of a steel profile. But I'm telling you two statements. First statement is impact of shear force would be mostly it is negligible. And the second thing is, even if it is sometimes really impacting this column size, then according to that only have to finalize this steel profile, uniformity of the taperedness of the profile. Is this clear to you?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Are you sure it is clear, or you want me to explain it further? Clear?
No, sir. It's clear. It's clear, sir. Thank you.
Yeah, any other questions, please? Any other questions from anyone, please? I think there are some questions from this chat box.
Students, if you have questions, please unmute and ask, or you can type in the chat box.
Any questions from anyone, please? Or is this clear that you have understood what I had explained for the last 1.5 hours? If something is unclear, please post a question. First, let me know, is this clear to everyone? If it is clear, you just post in the box, yes, it is clear. So that we can understand that it is at least clear to many of you. Is this clear to everyone? Can you please post? Yeah, there is one person who has responded. I think it's Varshini. Thank you, Varshini. How about others? Can you all please confirm if it is clear to all of you? Rohit, fantastic. How about others? Yeah, Priyadarshini, Naveen, and then Raman, Praveen Kumar, Janisha, Santosh Rajan, Darshini, quick! It's a matter of typing 2 to 3 words. I'm sure you are more experts using WhatsApp, then why can't you just make two words? Akash, Abhishek, Mr. Balagurgan, Balaji, Sugandhan, very nice name, Sugandhan, again Priyarashmi, Adarsh, Pradeep, fantastic. Prashant, Syed, yeah, that's fantastic to see your responses, but I would also be very happy if you can post your questions if something has to be clear to you. If nothing is understood, you can also open it and tell me that nothing is understood. So any more questions from you? There was only one question. And any more from you, please? Yeah, I think there are no questions from your end. And Ruby Modem, with your permission, I just wanted to say few words about upcoming webinar. If it is all right, I can proceed with this.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Thank you so much. And there are the webinars that we have already conducted in the last year, like analysis and design of S+4+ buildings using StatPro and then ETABS. And then we also have conducted all these live buildings design, like G+7+ buildings, which was done very recently, just a couple of weeks back only. And then we also have, conducted webinar on G+10 floors buildings. And we use this SAFe software for designing these foundations, manual design of foundations, PEB warehouses with the connections plus foundation design using StatPro and virtual internship programs. So these are all the things that we have been conducting. And in fact, we have almost 56 topics. In structural engineering, we have almost 56 topics, and we are going to plan and conduct everything. So far, we have conducted 18 webinars out of 56 topics. And this is the Google reviews that we have got from all the participants. who have attended all these interesting topics. And like we have got almost 4.7 out of 5 custom reviews. And this is upcoming webinar, which is going to begin from day after tomorrow. If there is anyone who is interested, they can also just consult a Ruby mail, or you can take my contact number, you can ask for the details. So here, this is the upcoming webinar detail, which is going to begin from day after tomorrow onwards. And moreover, whatever the fee that is mentioned here will be very even, will be definitely reduced for all the SP Engineering College or people who are attending this webinar, I mean this session for today. So this is upcoming webinar, which is going to begin on Monday. Design of Pile Foundations. This is a very rare topic, and it is also not easy to collect the information on the design of Pile Foundations. So whatever we have done in our past experience, we just have collected everything, and then wherever we used, wherever we faced all the challenges, whatever the difficulties that we faced in our experience, entire thing has been just accumulated at one point, and then we are going to share everything to you in the form of manual calculations, in the form of Start Pro, and we also will explain you everything that we have mentioned in this brief content. And we are from LSB-TVT, whoever is interested to attend any of our webinars, so you can just take note this number and post a message to me. So that is a very brief about it, and we of course you can also just go through this. And we have got so many things, so many people have given so many. You can just see here and go to this internet and type for this LSB-TVT. You can get so many things, like see here. Yeah, here you can see. These are the pictures. There are the structures that we have designed in our past experience. In the past, this is a temple building. These are the buildings that we have designed. We have designed these bridges also. We have experience on bridges. This is underground sump. This is a steel structure. The slab reinforcement, slab casting. And this is how we usually train the people. We have trained the people also in the universities. We went there and we stayed there for almost 1 week. We gave everything based on the structures that we are dealing in our consultancy only. It is not that we take some example from somewhere for which we cannot verify the result. We are designing the structures. We use to explain the same thing which are constructed and which are existing. So this is also the one of the things. This is how we also get involved. So this is also from Usmani University when we had conducted live workshop on ETAPS and then STAD. This is the building that is constructed in Anandapuram district. This is what is called a reference benchmark kind of thing. See. So this is offline training. It is an internship training that we have conducted for PhD and then UG student. And this is one of the seminars we have, workshops that we have conducted in university. These are also students. This one, the international conference. These are the elevations that we have designed for one of the hospital buildings. This is the one of the workshops the students have attended. Around 97 members have attended for this webinar, I mean this workshop. This is one of the university. These are all the students. And you can also see the reviews that we have got from all our students. See? And we used to get this kind of a paragraphs of reviews we used to get from all the participants. See? And many people from Chennai, especially from PWD, CEs, I mean, yes, Superintendent also have given a review here. Alena Sundaram sir are given, and the military engineering services colonels. Colonels also have attended our webinars, and they also are given the previous year. See, you can go through for any other details from this. And thank you so much, Surugi ma'am, for giving me this opportunity to interact with all the students. And whoever is interested to attend any of our webinars, you please contact us. And you can just note this number. This number 9980-3949. Yes, Surugi ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for this informative session. Now, I would like to request Mr. Tilak Rohit, our third year student, to propose a vote of thanks.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great privilege to give the vote of thanks for this webinar. On behalf of Department of Civil Engineering SVCE, I would like to thank our speaker, Mr. G. Sivaram Reddy, for enlightening us with his knowledge on analysis and design of steel pre-engineered buildings. The webinar was very interesting and informative. The on-field pictures and the detailing diagram that you shared with us gave more clear idea on the pre-engineered buildings. Thank you, sir, for sharing your precious time with us. I would like to thank our head of department, Dr. R. Kumuda ma'am, and coordinator, Ms. Ruby Freya ma'am, for organizing such a wonderful webinar. A heartfelt thanks for all the staff and the students who participated actively in this webinar. Thank you all once again.
Thank you so much, Mr. Rohit.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. And all the participants can please fill the feedback which is posted in the chat box. You will also be getting a certificate if you have filled the feedback form. Thank you once again, sir. Thank you all participants.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.